This story happened during the summer break of 2021. For some context, my name is Anita. I am a 28-year-old Haitian-American woman living in Miami, Florida. In April of 2021, me and my closest cousins named Janice and Julia decided to take a two-week trip to Haiti to visit family members. Our first week there went well, with no incidents. We were staying in a smaller town called Cap-Haitien. We spent time with our family and enjoyed the beach, beautiful scenery, and great food. But the next week is where things went south. We started off the week by driving to Port-au-Prince, the capital of Haiti. On the second day there, my cousins and I decided to run some errands in the afternoon. While we were out, we turned down a random street to buy some souvenirs from a street vendor. After we got out of the car, we saw a white Toyota Land Cruiser with blacked out windows speeding down the street, coming toward us. All of us, including the street vendor, went into full panic mode and ran away. I looked behind me to see one of the assailants exiting the SUV with an automatic weapon. He opened fire. Bullets flew past us, and we heard profanities being shouted in Creole. Thankfully, none of us were injured. We took refuge in a nearby alley, where we were spotted by a local who understood what was going on. He was kind enough to allow us to hide out in his apartment until the gunmen left the area. But the drama was far from over. We heard many gunshots outside and people screaming at each other. After what felt like 2 hours, we went to check outside and saw dead bodies and blood all over the street. We got out of there as soon as possible. Luckily for us, the rental car did not get stolen. It may have seemed like the men were targeting us, but it's more likely we accidentally stumbled into a turf war between rival gangs. We didn't bother calling the police because the Haitian police are some of the most corrupt on this planet. Many of them are gang members themselves. We went back home, completely traumatized. So for the rest of our stay, we didn't go out, and counted down the days until we returned to Florida. Things have only gotten worse in Haiti. There seems to be never-ending kidnappings, homicides, and street violence happening on the island. As much as it pains me to say, I will not be returning to Haiti anytime soon. I used to live in a study apartment here in Denmark back in 2017. Study apartments are basically very small, typically one-room apartments, serving as a way for young people to be able to move away from home, despite not having much money. There is usually a long wait to get into these apartments, but after signing up for the wait list, it wasn't long before I was approved to move in. It all happened so fast, and before I knew it, I had a place of my own. The apartment was located in a sketchy neighborhood. Mostly low-income families living off welfare or people with special needs who were dumped there by the government. This didn't bother me though. I got to have my very own place at a relatively young age, which was a huge accomplishment for me. Here I could hang out with my friends, bring my girlfriend over, and generally enjoy the feeling of being an adult. While I was living there, nothing creepy ever really happened, aside from dealing with an old lady who was mentally ill. She would always scream at other residents, cursing at them. She was the kind of crazy that made you always look around when you pulled into the parking lot. You might want to park elsewhere if she was out and about. I found out that she didn't pay her electric bill because she believed that the government was monitoring her. She also always wore a bicycle helmet because she wanted to shield her brain from aliens trying to snatch it. I knew all of this from my friend who was dating a girl who worked with elderly citizens. I never really felt unsafe in my apartment complex because of this. I was just aware of my surroundings, and I always made sure to lock my doors and check my apartment before going to bed. On the off chance that crazy old lady was hiding somewhere, thinking that I was a gray. However, one night, after a gaming session that lasted until around 3 a.m., I had just gone to bed and turned off my lights. I was very close to falling asleep, when suddenly, my doorbell rang. It was so loud and sudden that I almost flew out of bed. I sat up and carefully listened to the eerie silence that followed the ring. Mind you, this was 3 a.m., and I was not expecting any visitors. My front door had a wooden frame, with slot windows at the bottom and top, which I had covered with paper so that people could not see inside. But even with the paper covering the openings, the hallway light still outlined the silhouette of someone standing outside of my front door. Upon seeing this, I became alarmed as I approached.
Can I help you with something?
Please let me in. I need your help, please.
The voice sounded drunk, but in a fake, pretend kind of way.
What do you want? Who are you?
Please help me. I need your help. Please just let me inside.
No way, man. I don't even know who the fuck you are. Do you have any idea what time it is?
Just let me in, I swear. I'm not going to hurt you.
Hearing this made everything seem much more creepy than it already was. I grabbed my golf club from behind my door.
Listen, I don't know what you need help with, but you had better speak up, or I'm coming out there, and you're not going to like what happens.
I'm looking for number 86. Please, just let me in.
86? You're at 64. You're on the wrong level. Is this what you needed help with?
The man then started to loudly bang on my door. I grabbed the doorknob and prepared myself for a confrontation. Suddenly, the pounding stopped, and I could hear the man's phone vibrating.
Hello? Okay.
He then addressed me. His voice now sounded sharp and confident.
I don't need your help anymore.
He then slowly walked back down the hallway and left. I was in full combat mode, but now I was just confused and a bit freaked out by the situation. I don't really have any enemies that would send a hitman to come deal with me. Maybe the guy was at the wrong place, or perhaps it was just some psychopath messing with people at 3 o'clock in the morning. After this occurrence, I stayed up for about another hour or so, smoking cigarettes, and waiting to see if he would return, but he never did. To this day, I still have no idea what the person wanted. However, the sudden shift from sounding fake drunk to perfectly sober makes me think this wasn't your typical situation. Besides, who knocks on some random person's door at 3 a.m.? With all the lights off. Not to mention his comment about not hurting me. I think if I had opened that door, something bad would have happened. I'm glad I decided to keep it shut. This entire ordeal has shady written all over it. And I'm happy to say that nothing else like that happened again. And I ended up leaving that place 2 years later. This happened about 15 years ago. I was 21 years old and living in my very first apartment. It was a small bachelor apartment in a sketchy area. I grew up in a town that was known to be rough and tough, and I knew how to handle myself and learned at a young age to keep my head down and not go looking for trouble. My apartment building was behind a bar. A lot of the patrons of the bar would stand outside and smoke. When they did this, they would be facing my apartment. Most of the smokers would keep to themselves. A few would nod and say hello if I passed by, and I never had any issues. until one evening. That night, I came home from work. I passed by the bar and saw this extremely tall man outside smoking. As I passed, he stared daggers at me. I gave him a slight nod and he acknowledged me, but he just continued staring. It made me feel uncomfortable, but I didn't think much of it. About an hour later, I hear a knock at my door. It was odd because you have to buzz people into the building. The complex only had 8 units, and I didn't really know any of my neighbors. I froze because I didn't really want to talk to anyone, but the knocking continued. I finally shouted,
"Who is it?"
A voice on the other side replied,
"It's Tom."
"I don't know anyone named Tom. I think you must have the wrong apartment."
The voice then said,
"You don't know me, but I know you. Open up, so we can talk."
I walked over to the peephole and saw that it was the tall man from the bar. I loudly said,
"Fuck off or I'm calling the cops."
I then heard him walking away and heard the exit door opening and closing. It was gone, or so I thought. A few minutes later, I peeked out the window and saw that the tall man was standing in the parking lot. He seemed to be talking to himself. At this point, I'm freaking out. I called up my landlord, who lived in the building next to me. He told me to call the police, and in the meantime, he and his brother would go check things out. I call up the cops and I tell them what's going on. They said that they would send a car. Meanwhile, my landlord and his brother make their way to the parking lot. I watched out my window and saw them approaching the man. He took one look at them and then bolted. My landlord and his brother tried chasing him down, but he got away. 5 minutes later, the police arrive. I gave my version of events and also a description of the man. The officer stares at me and says,
"It's a good thing you didn't answer the door. We've had reports come in of a man matching that description who has sexually assaulted women."
A few days later, I get a call from the officer. He told me that as part of their investigation, they were talking to the owner of the bar. The owner informed them that the tall man appeared there a few days later, and the police responded and arrested him. This happened to me about 4 years ago. I was living with a roommate at an apartment complex in a bad area. It wasn't terrible, but it was right by a busy road that seemed to attract a lot of crime. As a woman, it was the kind of place you didn't want to walk around at night. I had, and had been harassed almost every time. This was before I had a car. It was about 3 a.m. My roommate was dead asleep. I was awake. Who knows why? I was in my room on the computer when I heard a knock at the door. It was literally just one knock. I took off my headphones to make sure I had actually heard it. After a few seconds of pause, another knock came. It then began a rhythm. It wasn't your typical someone knocking at the door wanting to see you. It was a slow, continuous one, almost like a heartbeat. Instantly, I was alarmed, but I decided to just leave it alone. I would wait and see if maybe it was some drunk who had gotten confused and would toddle off after a while. Minutes passed, and the knocking did not stop, and it never picked up or slowed down. It was just a continuous, rhythmic knocking. After some time, I heard the person try for the doorknob.
Instantly, I was fearing for my life. Without waking my roommate, I went into the living room and shouted through the door, "Who is it?" The knocking suddenly stopped. I decided to look out the peephole and see who it was. I know this sounds like a horror movie, but I saw nothing. At that point, I backed away, and after I did, the knocking resumed. My shouting had woken up my roommate, who was now asking what the hell was going on. I told her that someone was knocking at the door, and they must have been hiding around the side, because I couldn't see anybody there. We called up the police, and they arrived about 10 minutes later. During that 10 minutes, my roommate and I had locked ourselves inside the bathroom, while this psycho kept doing that slow knocking. Once the cops showed up, we were safe to come out and had a look at who was doing this to us. It was a boy probably no older than 18. They had him restrained and had confiscated a backpack from him. Inside the backpack was a shocking amount of drugs, and even worse, a knife. I had never seen this kid before, but we were told he lived across the parking lot from us, in the exact same complex. The kid wouldn't say what he was doing here, but the contents of his backpack sent deep chills through my body. I'm certain that he was planning to use the drugs on us, and then assault and possibly kill us. The kid was arrested and jailed for some time, not long enough in my opinion. But after he was released, I heard that he ran away. He had been living with his dad at the apartments. I haven't heard anything about him since, but my roommate and I moved to a nicer area shortly after this event. I seriously hope he gets locked up again, because it's clear he had every intent to victimize us, and I have no doubts that he would try it again. I'll never forget the way he knocked at our door. It filled me with a sense of dread I had never felt in my life. About 2 years ago, I rented a room in a three-bedroom house. The walls were very thin. My bedroom had one window, which led into the living room, none with outside access. This window will be important later on. There was three bedrooms, one for me, one for the master tenant, and one spare, which at the time was rented out by a pretty friendly guy. Well, friendly guy had issues with his work visa and had to move back to Canada last minute, leaving us about 2 weeks to find another roommate. Our quickest and easiest option was Craigslist. Due to my work schedule, I had no part in the selection process, but I was content when the new roommate moved in a bit later. Something was off about this guy, but he seemed friendly enough. He was a very tall, large man, and was very quiet. Not somebody who I wanted to go out of my way to hang out with, but was still okay to be around. 2 weeks after he moved in, the master tenant left for Hawaii, leaving me and the new tenant alone. For the first few days, things were normal. However, that all changed one night. I was woken up at about 8 a.m. to a frantic knocking on my door. The new roommate, we'll call him Kyle, was standing there when I opened up, looking frazzled. He looks me dead in the eye and asks, "So do you want to tell me what was going on last night?" To which I was shocked and confused. Last night I had come home from work at about 9 p.m. and immediately showered and went to bed. I explained this to him, and he says that he heard me screaming, that he saw me through the window, arguing with our landlord, who I had never met in person at this point. He claimed that he heard people coming in and out of our house. I tell him no way. None of that ever happened. After staring at me for a bit longer, he leaves. The next morning I wake up to the same thing. This time he says he saw me arguing with my boyfriend, I was single at the time. He said that he saw me talking with the master tenant, who, as I mentioned before, was in Hawaii. He also asked me for the badge number of the officer I was talking to. Apparently, he saw a bunch of police as well. This time, I get angry, and I more or less tell him to cut this shit out. I'm not doing anything, and I have no idea what you're talking about. He got this weird look on his face and said, I think I had a seizure in my sleep. Next time that happens, call the ambulance. After that, he left. But about an hour later, he begins knocking at my door again. When I open up, Kyle repeats the same exact story, verbatim. I tell him to leave me alone, and then I left for work. My workday went about as expected. I'm a bit reluctant to return home, but I was too tired to crash at somebody else's place. Big mistake. At about 1 a.m., I wake up to doors slamming. Kyle is pacing back and forth between his bedroom and the living room, then to the front door, walking in and out of each room, turning the lights on and off, mumbling angrily to himself. I can see his shadow pacing back and forth through the frosted window in my room. Since my room is dark, he can't see inside. Suddenly he screams,
I can't live like this anymore. Why are you doing this to me?
I thought he was on the phone, so I didn't respond. A few moments later, he screams my name. I then realized his statements were directed at me. I knew I had to get out of there, so I quietly crept out of bed and start getting dressed, packing up bags of clothes for work in the morning. I'm almost done when he screams,
I can hear you.
He then charges over to my room, slapping the wall next to my door, but not touching the door itself. I look toward my window, and I see his shadow lean all the way forward, pressing his ear against the glass. I was fucking terrified, and I sat completely still, not moving a muscle. He eventually screams my name again and moves away from the window. I hear him start pacing between rooms again. Now my shoes are kept on a rack outside my door and not inside my room, so I know that when I leave, I'm going to need a moment to put them on. I decided to wait until he was back in his room, at which time I plan to grab my shoes, put them on, and run. As I'm formulating this plan, the pacing stops. He then screams,
Do you want to fight about this? Come on out right now, and we'll fight, I swear to God.
Now, I am a very small girl, and only 5 feet tall. This guy is easily 3 times my size, so I'm definitely not looking to fight. After a few minutes, he turns off all the lights, and I hear the door to his room open and close, followed by silence. I wait for a moment to be sure I can't hear any movement, and then I decided to take my chance. I took a breath and opened my door quickly, then stepped out and grabbed my shoes, before looking up a second later to see him standing there in the dark hallway with nothing but a pair of boxers and socks on. He then spoke in a low, calm voice, Ma'am, we need to talk. That was a hard no from me, so I grabbed my shoes and ran out the front door with them in hand. I ran about half a block barefoot before stopping and putting them on. When I looked behind me, I saw him standing in the porch light of our front door, watching me run, but not moving. Luckily for me, I had a friend who lived about 2 blocks away, and I had their spare key on me. So I let myself in and crashed there for the night, and that's where I stayed for the next week. while we work things out with our landlord. Kyle agreed to move out within the week. He said he didn't remember anything that happened, and wasn't sure if it was real or not. But if I said that's what went down, then it must be true. The day Kyle left, he sent me a photo of the house keys sitting on the table, along with a message that said, "I'm out." I take a friend over there with me to scout it out, and to make sure he actually left. When we got there, we discovered that not only did he leave a bunch of food and furniture behind, but he had ripped out all the fire alarms from the ceiling, and had unscrewed and removed the deadbolt from the front door, and left them lined up neatly on the front table. The door to my bedroom can only be locked by using a key from the outside, and had been locked when we arrived, which meant that Kyle still had a key to my room. We called the locksmith right away. Even after the locks were changed, I was still terrified to stay there alone, and never went to sleep at night without barricading the doors with chairs and other furniture. To this day, I still fear for his safety. He obviously had some kind of psychological condition, but I also wonder what could have happened to me if I hadn't been as lucky as I was. A few weeks ago, I had to fly out to a small town I had never been to in order to look for a place to live. I'm moving there in the fall to start grad school. My boyfriend flew with me. Before the trip, I researched all sorts of apartments on Craigslist and set up a bunch of appointments. Our first appointment was in the afternoon, in this sort of remote residential area. The landlord sounded fine over email and asked me to call him about an hour before the appointment to confirm that I was still coming. I called, but he didn't answer. So my boyfriend and I started walking to the house and just hoped that he would show up. About 10 minutes before the appointment, the guy calls me.
"Hey, are you coming?"
He sounded like an older man and had this very strange, slow way of talking, but I just thought he was older. "Yes, we're in front of the house now." He then got extremely upset.
"We?"
"Oh yeah, my boyfriend's with me."
"You never told me you had a boyfriend. You never said that."
It had never crossed my mind to tell him this information, since my boyfriend would not be coming to live with me. He was just helping me look for apartments on the trip. I told the man, and after a very long pause, he said,
"I'm sorry. It's just, sometimes, people don't tell me when they're married, and it surprises me. I'll see you soon."
He then hung up. I told my boyfriend about what the man said, and he was immediately weirded out. He wanted to leave, but there were slim pickings in terms of real estate, so I stupidly said that we had to stay in case this was the place. As we were discussing this, we see a man leave the house we were going to view. This man was young and extremely sketchy looking. He took one look at us and ran to his car and pulled away from the curb with a screech. Okay, so now we're really starting to get creeped out. But this isn't enough for us to just bail. Yet. Me and my boyfriend looked at each other, wondering what to do. Soon, the landlord arrives. He looked to be in his 50s, very tall and strong looking. His eyes were completely blank and devoid of emotion. He slowly walks up to us and says, "I would shake your hands, but mine are dirty."
"Where from?"
my boyfriend asks. "Work," he flatly responds. He then asks me a lot of questions, completely ignoring my boyfriend. What am I going to school for? What other places am I considering for living? Is my boyfriend moving to this town as well? The entire time, he stares into my eyes without blinking.
I try to give him answers that are as vague as possible. Meanwhile, my boyfriend is asking the landlord the same kind of questions, which he refuses to answer any of them. He then says, out of nowhere, "Let me show you the basement." At this point, we really should have left, but we didn't. I kept thinking that this was an eccentric old man from a small town, and we're city folk, and he was just feeling paranoid. My boyfriend, on the other hand, wanted to get out of there, but he followed us, as the man led us to the back of the house, away from the street, to this sort of detached shed. He opened the door, and we saw that there were stairs leading down into utter darkness. He flipped the switch at the top of the stairs, and the light did not turn on. Normally, the response for this would be, "Oh shit, the light's out," or something like that. But he just says, and slowly walked down into the darkness. He then just stood there, without moving, in the dark, then said, "Aren't you coming down?"
There's nothing to see if the light's out," says my boyfriend.
The landlord just stands there for a long time, then slowly walks back up the stairs and closes the basement door without saying anything. He took us into the house. Weird and increasingly creepy things ensued. The front door, the only exit to the house, locked automatically. When my boyfriend tried to fiddle with it, the man became very upset and told him to leave it alone. He managed to get it open secretly, though. The man kept trying to box us into small rooms and kept reaching his hands into his pockets, only to take them away when he caught us looking. On Craigslist and in person, the man claimed that there was a grad student already living in the house, but the evidence of that seemed arranged. There were neat piles of generic textbooks on the table, but not things a 20-something-year-old might read. There was a bowl of fruit on the table, but there was no other food in the fridge or pantry, or even utensils. There were maybe 3 t-shirts in the closet, and the landlord couldn't say what school he went to or how long he had been renting the house. Finally, the man had showed us every single room except for one. He claimed that the one he refused to open for us was just the attic, and we didn't need to see anything up there. He gave us several reasons when we inquired. It was unfinished. There was furniture up there. It would smell bad. The last one I believed, because when I stood near the door, it smelled terrible. After a while, we made our excuses and got out of there. The man walked us out, then got into his car, but when he thought we had turned the corner, he exited his car and slowly sauntered back into the house. My boyfriend, fixated on the idea that there was something off about this guy, Googled him that night. We found out 3 things. That he was a pillar of the community, known by a lot of the townspeople. There is no evidence of him owning or managing real estate, as he claimed on Craigslist. And that he had listed his home address as the very house we had been touring. So that was definitely the creepiest thing that's ever happened to me. When I was 21, I transferred to a college in San Francisco. I checked out a room for rent on Craigslist. It was a really nice 2-bedroom apartment. It was cheap rent and close to campus, so it was the ideal spot. The girl who lived there was 29, and her name was Beth. She was tall and wide, had jet black hair, and wore pale makeup. She seemed nice, although a bit quiet. She seemed to like me, and agreed to allow me to move in. So far, so good. My first night there, we went out for pizza, and that's when I could tell that there was something a bit off about her. Throughout dinner,
She kept telling me how much I looked like Shia LaBeouf. I didn't know what to say, so I just shrugged it off with a, thanks? I mean, I look nothing like Shia LaBeouf, so it didn't make any sense to me. When we got back home, she asked me if I had seen her room yet. I said no, and she took me to see it. Her walls were covered in posters of Shia LaBeouf. She even had printed out photos of him all over her mirror. She owned all of his movies. I didn't know what to make of it. This was creepy. The whole night she had been saying that I looked like him. And now it's obvious to me that she's obsessed with the guy. A few weeks pass, and I don't really see her that much. She would come home from work and practically run into her room. But sometimes at night, I would hear this creepy high-pitched giggling through the walls. I wondered what the hell she could possibly be doing in there. Occasionally she would come out and talk to me for about 2 minutes, and would always be slurring her words, so I suspected she was drinking a lot. Sometimes she wouldn't say anything. She would just stand in the hallway, watching me. I would turn and see her and be surprised and say,
Hello, Beth.
Then there would be this long, awkward pause, and she would give me her creepy, high-pitched giggle. It was uncomfortable being around her. She gave me the chills. One night I woke up at around 2 a.m. because I heard what sounded like the front door being unlocked. I came out of my bedroom. All the lights were off, but I could see Beth standing by the front door. She had her face against it, and she was turning the lock back and forth, over and over again. Every time she turned the bolt, she mumbled my name. Max Baker. Max Baker. Max Baker. Seeing her standing in the dark, mumbling my name, really freaked me out. And it doesn't help that she kind of looks like a bigger version of the girl from The Ring. I just quietly went back into my room and tried to get some sleep. One night I was watching Gladiator, and she stumbles out of her room and turns on the living room light, forcing me to pause the movie. She then asked me if I wanted to hear about her ex-boyfriend. It was an uneasy segue into the topic, but I just said, sure, and then awkwardly sat back and listened to her. 10 minutes into her story, she was very worked up. She was screaming at the top of her lungs about her breakup, and she wasn't listening to me when I asked her to lower her volume. I was worried that one of the neighbors was going to call the police. While she was screaming, she said something that really freaked me out. She was in such a fit and blurted out,
"I'll slit his throat!"
That was a big game changer. I had no idea what this woman was capable of. She was practically a stranger, and everything I had seen was becoming disturbing. After a few more minutes, she told me,
"Thanks for listening."
I got out of there pretty fast and went to my room to go to sleep. I had a pretty unsettling feeling about being in the same apartment as her. And what's worse, there was no lock on my bedroom door. I pushed the edge of the dresser in front of it to act as a barricade. I woke up in the middle of the night to the sound of my dresser scraping against the floor. Beth was pushing the door open. I turned on my light, shouting at her to stop. I could see her through the opening. She was drunk and had this insane look in her eyes. I pushed the door closed and yelled at her to go to bed. I could hear her walk back to her room, but I couldn't fall back to sleep. The next morning, when I went out into the hallway, my heart dropped.
I saw one of her steak knives on the floor by my door. I got goosebumps all over my arms. All I could think about was her saying what she would do to her ex-boyfriend's throat. I confronted her about it, and she said that she didn't remember trying to push my door open, and didn't even remember the conversation we had about her ex. By this point, I had enough. My lease was month to month, so I found a new spot and moved out. About a month after I left, she contacted me. I was at the movies and my phone was off. When I got out, I turned on my phone, and I was shocked to see that she had sent me over 40 messages over the course of the past 2 hours. They were all just insane texts that ranged from everything between,
"Hi, how are you?"
to,
"I fucking hate you."
It was just insane. I didn't respond, and I never heard from her again. I've always wondered, what would have happened if I didn't set my dresser by my door that night? Would she have quietly entered my room with a knife? Ugh, that just freaks me out. This happened at my parents' house when I was 14 or 15 years old. I'm 25 now, but thinking about it still gives me goosebumps. It was nearing the end of my summer break, and my parents decided that they were going to go on one more fishing trip before students started going back to school. My mom ran a cafe in front of the high school. They gave me the usual rundown of how to reach them and blah blah blah, and they were on their way. They took my dad's Jeep. My mom's car was in the shop at the time, so going out was completely out of the question for me. So I did what any teenage girl would do with a house empty of adults in a fully stocked bar. My dad was quite the drinker. I stayed home all weekend and ate junk food and binged every B horror film that my dad had rented from Netflix. This was back in the mail order DVD days. It was Saturday night, technically Sunday morning, and I was downstairs on my dad's leather recliner, bowl of popcorn in hand, eyes glued to the television as I watched Ring You. I had all the lights off to get myself into that horror movie feel, when I had to tinkle. I didn't want to turn on the lights because I'm lazy. So I walked over to the bathroom by the front door and did my business. I didn't bother turning on the bathroom light, because again, I'm lazy. As I sat there pondering the plot of Ring You, I looked up at the window that faced the front yard. It's an oval window, and instead of buying curtains for it, my dad used some of that frosted privacy film. It basically keeps anyone from looking in, but you can still vaguely see things on the other side. Well, as I'm zoned out, I noticed something quite odd. There's a shape in the window that looks a lot like a person standing there. Now, the reason I say this was odd was because the front porch lights were off. There was a shadow because of the street light in front of our house. As my gears were turning, the shadow moved out of sight. It was at that exact moment that I realized that whoever was out there got past the lights without them going off. Like most porch lights, ours are motion sensitive. Actually, they were super sensitive. A larger leaf falling would set them off. The only way not to make those lights go off is if you went around the side of the house and crawled over the banister. As I came to this realization, I also noticed that this person was standing outside of our front door. I awkwardly slid off the toilet, pulled my pants up, and did a military-style crawl to the living room, and proceeded to freak the fuck out. Whoever this individual was had to have practiced not making the lights go off. Also, there were no cars in the driveway. There's always my dad's Jeep or my mom's car in the driveway. This was the first time that our driveway was empty, so they probably thought that nobody was home. As I'm lying on the floor, my ears perked up at the sound of someone pacing. Now I'm scared that they're going to break in and see this small girl all alone in the house. So I crawled my way to the kitchen. I grabbed a phone, and as I did that, the footsteps outside stop. As if someone left the porch. I turned to look at the front door and realized that the lights haven't turned on, so that means the person jumped off the side. I looked toward the back door. My eyes then fell upon a window with its blinds raised. You see, we keep these blinds up by the kitchen because of our two cats. Those little shits will destroy the blinds if they can't see outside. So I ran over to the window, closed the blinds, and sat on the floor. I have no idea if the person saw me, but if they knew that much about the porch lights, they would know that those blinds are always raised. There's still a glow from the TV, so I didn't see anyone when I ran over, but now I'm twice as horrified. I sat there for a bit, straining to hear any movement outside, but I wasn't hearing anything until I heard the porch door shaking. My dad put a hook on the porch door so that we could let out the cats without them running away, but most of the time my mom forgets to hook it closed. The reason that I heard the door shake was because my dad must have locked it last time he was out there. I was in full panic mode now. Three things. One, this person knows how to maneuver past the porch lights. Two, they knew about the uncovered window that I hopefully covered in time. And three, they knew about the porch door being unlocked 99.9% of the time. Now, while I should have called the police at this time like a smart person, I actually called my dad. As the phone is ringing, I'm making sure the back door, the garage door, and the front door are all locked. It took a while, but my dad answers the phone half pissed and half worried. I tell him not to freak out, but that I'm freaking out. I told him what was going on.
Why aren't you calling the police? What the fuck?
And at this point, I'm in my parents' room, and I flick on all the lights. I was hoping that with my parents' bedroom light on, it would give off the image that an adult was present in the home. He said he would call the neighbors, and for me to hang up and call the police. Before I called the police, I casually turned on every light in the house. By casually, I mean I ran around the house like a crazy person. When the police arrived, nobody was found. In fact, I was afraid to open the door to the cop that knocked. I demanded that he show me some form of identification. He showed me his badge, and I called the police station to confirm his identity. The neighbors let my parents know that I was safe, and they didn't find whoever was walking around the house. My parents drove home right after, and my neighbors stayed with me until they arrived. For the following week, I was horrified to be home alone. I refused to open the blinds for the cats or to use the downstairs bathroom. Not to mention we have woods as our backyard, so I was terrified that whoever it was skulking around the woods. The scariest part was that at the end of the following week, a woman's house was broken into and she was assaulted. Her husband was out of town on a business trip, and the perp broke into her house through the back door. Just knowing that if I was asleep, or if they realized a teenage girl was home alone, I would have had a completely different experience. Before I tell my story, let me set the scene. It was the summer of 1996, and I was 15 years old. I grew up in a good neighborhood, in a typical Swedish university town with my dad. I was a pretty well-behaved kid, did very good in school, didn't smoke or drink. In fact, I didn't even want to go to any parties. I didn't have a boyfriend at the time, but I did have a crush on a guy from school. And I felt pretty sure that he was curious about me too, but I guess we were both shy people. This took place at the end of August, when the light summer nights start to slowly grow darker and the days get shorter. It was a very hot summer, and all the popular girls would wear these white tight tops to show off their midriffs. And one day I bought myself one, just to try and see what it was like to be a normal teenage girl. I had those silly shoes on too, the Spice Girl ones that sprained many ankles during that era. Looking back now, I wonder if it was this outfit that started it all. I began to start getting notes. They were placed in the basket of my bicycle. Notes with messages like, "I like your style, baby," and "growing into a woman before my eyes." I didn't tell anyone. I strongly suspected the idiot gang at my school. Two of them lived close to me, and I thought that they were teasing me for changing my style. Teenage logic. We've all been there, right? To show them that I didn't care, I wore my new style all the time. One morning I noticed that someone had stepped on the flowers in the flower beds under several of our windows. I told my dad about it. He was worried that somebody was checking the place out, planning to break in, and asked me to turn on the alarm whenever I was alone. Things had gone missing before, insignificant things, but still, you never know. My dad owned a rather successful business, and to celebrate the 10-year mark, he wanted to treat his employees to a weekend getaway, and had booked a place up north. I was used to being home alone. Sometimes his work demanded that he travel for a week or so, and it wasn't a problem. Again, I was a pretty good kid. Anyway, a few houses down the street lived a couple that we knew, and they usually checked in on me if I was alone for a few days. They had no kids of their own, and often helped out with everyone else's. It was on the Saturday that it happened. I arrived home very late, on my bicycle, after having watched Cutthroat Island at a friend's place. I walked in the front door and noticed a draft. Had I forgotten to close the window before I left? I then noticed that the alarm was turned off. Had I forgotten about that too? I walked through the house into the living room, when suddenly, Mr. W, the man from down the street, stood in front of me. "Hi there, kiddo. Did I scare you? I just came to check in on you." I found this strange, since it was well past 1 a.m. He smelled of alcohol.
I'm fine, Mr. W. I'll be going off to bed now."
Despite it being a hot summer night, I felt a chill crawl down my back. Something inside of me told me that this was an extremely dangerous situation. Something about him was off. It was as if he was wearing a mask, as if somebody else was behind those eyes. Not the friendly Mr. W that I had known my entire life.
"Wine?"
he said, and nodded in the direction of a bottle. I shook my head no.
I don't drink. My dad, you know?"
I tried to sound normal, but my voice didn't feel like my own.
"Oh, you're almost a grown woman now. You can do as you wish,"
he continued, pouring wine into an unwashed glass.
"I've been watching you. You've really grown."
He kept telling me how beautiful I had become, and how he noticed my new clothes. That surely I knew that was an open invitation to men.
"I'm a nice person, don't you think? I'll be good to you. You can trust me. I'll be real gentle."
I started back toward the front door, but he stops me by grabbing a hold of my upper arm and pulling me towards him.
"Hey, you don't be like that. Nobody likes a tease."
When I try to break free, he laughs and goes,
"You want to play, huh? I can play."
He then begins to shake me. I feel how much stronger he is than I, and I realize I have to make him let go long enough for me to run. At this point, it was as if I was somebody else, and I began saying and doing things that I wasn't even aware of until afterward.
Yeah, I like to play,"
I heard myself say. He smiles, and begins to caress my hair. We made our way to my dad's bedroom, and I tried to pretend to be into it. The moment he tossed me down, I said,
Go lock the front door and turn on the alarm.
I tried to look eager and not scared out of my mind.
Okay, don't move, he says as he walks away.
I was on my feet faster than I thought possible, and I locked the bedroom door from the inside. My plan, however, had not turned out as I had hoped. He had taken me to my dad's bedroom, not my bedroom. My bedroom had a window that led out to the roof of the garage. From there, I could have jumped down, but my dad's room had no such escape. But it did have a phone. My brain had forgotten the number to the police. Remember that this is in Sweden. It isn't 911. The only other number I remembered was my dad's work number. When I called it, he answered almost right away. My dad immediately called the cops from his other phone. While I still had him on the line, Mr. W was trying to pick the lock with a screwdriver, shouting at me and promising to gut me like a fish. My dad also called another neighbor, Mr. K, who used to be in the military and would often brag about how he would treat any burglar to a trip to the emergency room if he ever got the chance. Mr. K arrived before the police, and he didn't break his promise. But the sound of fighting outside the room was terrible, and I had no idea who was on the winning side. Mr. K was older but very fit, but what if Mr. W had a weapon? I don't think I even breathed until I heard Mr. K say,
"Hey kid, are you okay?"
I didn't dare leave that room before the police arrived. I was almost unable to move. It was as if my mind had escaped my body. A man who I had known since childhood had suddenly started to stalk me and planned to use the fact that my dad was out of town to do God knows what to me. I trusted him, and I had been so wrong. I still have trust issues to this day. I spoke to Mr. W's wife once, long after this incident. She filed for divorce and told me that the reason that she refused to have children with him was that deep down, she knew they would not have been safe in their home. Mr. W has since passed away, and to be honest, I'm glad. This story is about my dad's crazy ex-girlfriend. My dad has horrible luck with women. He's like a crazy magnet. Every woman he's ever dated, except for his current girlfriend, has been abusive both mentally and physically. This list includes my mother. But this story is about his last girlfriend, Mary. She has gone from stalking not only him, but me, my husband, and our daughter too. They met at a Christmas party and hit it off. He had just gotten out of another bad relationship with a different woman that he had been on and off with for about 3 years. She was the classic narcissist type. Well, Mary seemed different. She claimed that she was also just out of an abusive relationship. They were dating for about 3 months, but she would never allow him over at her place. He didn't find it weird until he received a call from a man who claimed to be Mary's husband and wanted to know how my dad knew her. At first, my dad thought this guy was her ex still trying to control her, but things began to add up. He finally confronted Mary, and she gave him this sob story about how her ex was refusing to sign the papers, but they were still separated. But my dad did a bit of digging, and even talked to Mary's parents at one point. He found out that not only was Mary definitely still married, but was not even separated from her husband. As far as everybody in her life knew, she was happily married and my dad was just a friend, if they knew about him at all. Needless to say, he broke up with her. And that's when she lost it. She began showing up at my dad's job, calling in the middle of the night, and texting him over 50 times a day. All of the classic hallmarks of an insane stalker. My dad moved states twice and changed his number several times to try to get away from her, but she always seemed to find him. Love letters would arrive in the mail, or she would call saying that she was coming to see him. Then somehow she discovered my phone number, probably sometime after my dad moved. She started texting me almost as much as him. Once I married my husband and my daughter was born, she really went all out, sending me presents for her new granddaughter, always wanting me to give her updates. I never replied, and either sent back the unopened packages or donated the items she had sent directly to me from the shops. Everything came to a head when she arrived at my dad's doorstep with a casserole. She handed it over to his roommate and told him she made this because she noticed that my dad was losing weight. My dad's roommate tossed it out for him. He didn't want to risk being poisoned since he had just applied for a restraining order. That same night, she showed up at my apartment. It was after 1 a.m. when she started knocking at my door. I was grateful that I had sent my toddler to my aunt and uncle's. She left banana bread at my doorstep that we threw out as soon as my husband got home. The very next night, I again left my daughter with my aunt and uncle in case she came back. And it turns out, she did. I started receiving waves of text messages from her as she pounded on my door. She wanted to see her grandchild and have some girl time with me. They slowly evolved into demands for me to open up the door. Of course, I called the police. While I was on the phone with the dispatcher, my neighbor had already come out ready to take her on. He told her that the cops were on the way because his wife had already called them. She disappeared into the park across the street after that. The cops didn't find her that night, but my dad's restraining order was granted. We have since moved across the state, but she still texts me from time to time, wanting to know how my dad is or what my daughter is up to. I never answer, but I do save all of her messages, just in case I have to file my own restraining order someday. I have to apologize in advance. I'm not the most amazing storyteller, but I'm going to try to write everything down as I remember it happening. I used to date this guy named Norman back in high school. I'm 29 now, and I have a 9-year-old daughter, so this must have been around 12 to 13 years ago. I guess we were each other's first real love relationship. We even wore promise rings, which was a pretty big deal back then. We talked about getting married and what our life together would be like. Basically, things people say or do when they've been together a year as teenagers. So as things go on, we began to argue and fell into a cycle of breaking up and getting back together. I was immature and stupid, and I ended up getting together with another guy during one of our breakup periods. It became a messy love triangle situation, and Norman and I finished for good after I chose this other guy. Not my proudest moment, but I was 17, and I lacked insight. Fast forward a few years later, I made a Facebook account, and out of curiosity one day, I looked up Norman. We added each other on Facebook, and I messaged him apologizing for what happened between us. I was happily married at this time, and we had just had our daughter. Norman was a good sport about it, and we remained amicable friends through social media. I really only ever talked to him to say happy birthday, or randomly comment on a status. Another few years go by, and Norman gets into a relationship with a woman named Marissa. I was happy to see him moving on. My own marriage hadn't worked out, but I was happy with my life and with raising my daughter on my own. During Christmas one year, I found an old Polaroid of me and Norman outside of a cabin. It was back when we were dating. I messaged him telling him about it, and I recalled how much fun we had had. He didn't reply, and this was before those scene stamps underneath the messages and later I found out I was no longer on his friends list. A few months later, I get a message from Marissa. She basically called me names and said that she saw the message I had sent him months ago. She told me never to contact him again and that I needed to get over him. She went on to boast about how a charm bracelet he had once given me was nothing compared to what he bought her these days. She said that the silver promise rings were BS, and he had bought her a beautiful gold engagement ring with several diamonds. Well, I never responded to that craziness. I got off of Facebook, and not long afterwards, I ended up making an entirely new profile and adding only my close friends and family. Over the next few years, I would get requests from people I didn't know. I somehow knew that it was all her, because the first account that I had mistakenly added began sending me abusive messages, calling me all kinds of names and saying that I would never find true love. Afterwards, I never added anyone else again that I personally did not know. I don't know how she kept finding my other accounts. She tried adding me on Instagram, Twitter, and she even somehow found out what my phone number was. When Snapchat became a thing, I got a request from a user who was using one of my Facebook friends' names, but on their profile it had whore and bitch in cursive writing on paper. I kept blocking and maintaining no contact because honestly, there was nothing else I felt I could do. This year I had joined a dating app and I met a guy within the first week. His name was Nate, and he had a few pictures of himself. He was average looking, so it didn't raise any red flags with me. He said that he had an Android phone, so he couldn't FaceTime me. However, we could talk on the phone. It was definitely a man's voice that I was conversing with. We texted over the next few weeks, and things seemed to be going well, so I thought it would be okay for a meetup. So we scheduled a time and place. A week before this was supposed to happen, he asked me about my past relationships. I didn't think too much of it when he asked me about my first real relationship. He seemed keen on details and asked me if I had feelings for my ex. I assured him I didn't, but that I also didn't hate him because I was the one who messed things up. And he was actually a very good guy. We talked a lot about that relationship, and then he said he was looking forward to meeting me. We had chosen to meet at an outdoor cafe, because I didn't like the idea of him showing up at my house, since I didn't actually know who he was. I was very excited. This was my first date in a very long time. So imagine my confusion when I saw a woman spot me and smile and started walking over. When she sat down, I was too shocked to say anything, and yes, it was Marissa. She had a smug look on her face, and she said, "Hey, babe," and kept smiling. She confessed that it was her the entire time. At that point, I honestly didn't know what to say. What did I ever do to this girl to get all these reactions from her? And for her to invest all this time into doing this to me. This is what she told me. Almost 6 years ago, when she and Norman got together, he told her about his first relationship. She went on his friends list and saw me, and went through all my pictures and posts, trying to see what he saw in me. Then when I messaged him, she confronted him over why I had any pictures of me and him together, and why he needed to have me on Facebook. That's when he unfriended me and promised her that he would never talk to me again. She told me that she hated me and said that I was someone who loves playing games with people's emotions and that she wanted to give me a taste of it. She said that she made up all these accounts so she could keep an eye on me and make sure that I wasn't going to be in the same city as her and Norman. I live outside their city, by the way. She would walk by places I mentioned that I would be at, to make sure that Norman wasn't meeting up with me. She also knew where I worked through my LinkedIn. She even recruited one of her friends to play the role of Nate on the phone. The most disturbing part, however, was when it came to my daughter. This woman had actually become extremely fixated on my daughter. She was convinced that she shared some similarities with Norman and had become obsessed, thinking I had a kid with him that I kept secret. She told me to not even think about suddenly revealing it to him as some ploy to get back together with him, and that she would be the only one to give him a baby. I was beyond horrified. All I remember doing was getting up from the table and telling her never to contact me again. I got on my car and just sat there in silence for a bit. The first thing I did was call my daughter's school and alert the front desk of a possible situation where someone who wasn't me or her father would try to pick her up. I called up my brother afterwards and told him what happened. He urged me to call the police. I did, but I ended up getting the whole spiel about I didn't have any documented proof it's her, so they really couldn't help me out. It's been 2 months. I haven't heard anything from her. My brother thinks that she got what she wanted by asserting herself as Norman's one and only, and now she would leave me alone. Still, I have massive paranoia when it comes to what I post on social media and where she might be lurking next. I have told my family and close friends about the situation and warned them not to add any strange profiles. I also showed my neighbors a picture of Marissa so that they could call the police if they saw her around the house. I wouldn't put it past her to know my address and start peeping in on our windows. I also changed out the locks as a precaution. I'm going to warn everybody ahead of time. This might be a tad bit lengthy, as I have quite a bit to say, and well, a lot has happened over the last year when it comes to this girl. I'm going to start off by saying that I was with her on and off for almost 6 years. The on and off part should have been a good indication that I should have jumped ship a long time ago, but I constantly allowed her to burrow back into my life. There really should be a subreddit called "Shit My Crazy Ex-Girlfriend Has Done," or something close to that, because I have enough stories involving this girl that I could write a book. Hell, I could write a whole TV series. I'll give you some information about our relationship and what caused me to break up with, well, I'll call her crazy, because that's what she is. About 2 years ago or so, Crazy started calling and texting me after we had been broken up for about 6 months. At first, I decided that I was just going to ignore her, because I knew if I let her back in, things would just go to hell in a handbasket again. However, one night I had been drinking, and I got this lame-ass sentimental feeling and decided to answer one of her texts. That was all it took. She started coming over, and eventually we ended up together again. We were together for close to 7 months before I finally got fed up with her shit and kicked her out of my apartment. She was physically abusive and a mental mind fuck. If I didn't let her use my car whenever she wanted, gave her money whenever she claimed that she needed it, or basically do whatever the hell she asked, she would have a tantrum like a 3-year-old and caused more drama than any one person could endure. During our time together, she managed to get herself into some real trouble after she beat some dude over the head with a beer mug at a local bar we frequented. What really ended the relationship was when she started using meth and was bringing that shit into my home. I tried getting her help, but she turned it around on me, as if I was trying to change her. So I gave up and told her mother that she needed to get her daughter the fuck out of my place before I called the cops and had her removed. I told her that we were done, and I never wanted to hear from her again. At this point, I had given her multiple opportunities to change, but she outright refused and made it seem like I was the problem. Whatever. I was done. The problem was, she definitely was not.
The day it finally ended was the beginning of her torment. She started her attack by creating a Craigslist ad under the escort section with a fake picture and my phone number as a contact. I received over 500 calls and text messages from random men looking to get laid. This lasted for about a week before it calmed down. If that wasn't enough, the same night while my phone was blowing up, I see the security guard from my apartment complex nosing around my car, shining his flashlight in the windows. I go outside and ask the guy, "Is there a problem? I got a report that this car here is abandoned and needs to be removed." "Oh, the fuck it does. That's my car. And I live in the apartment right over there." I ended up having to get my title and a valid driver's license to keep this douchebag from calling the towing company and having my shit removed. The next day rolls around, and I'm still getting a massive amount of texts and calls through my whole workday, which was really pissing me off. I get home after work and sit down to try to relax when there came a knock at my door. I look out and I see some guy I've never met before standing outside. I don't answer. I wait for him to leave. And then I look down my balcony and see this guy on his phone, standing right out front. I yell down to him,
"Hey, can I help you? Is Crazy here?" "No, that's my ex. I kicked her out the other day. Maybe check her mom's house where she's staying."
I ended up talking to this guy further. It turns out that she set up a dinner date with him and gave him my address as where she was staying. That night, another three guys showed up looking to have a dinner date with her. I had work the next day, and while I'm there, she starts sending me text messages, pictures of outside my apartment, with messages like, "It's quite breezy in the apartment with your patio door open. I hope your dog finds his way back home." So needless to say, this shit was stressing me out the entire day. At the time, I was almost positive it was bullshit, but there's always a chance that Crazy actually broke in. I got home later to find my apartment the way I had left it, but the pure mindfuck of it all was close to giving me an ulcer. This entire time, I'm ignoring her, hoping that this shit will come to an end soon. But no, it only escalates. Once again, after work, I get a knock at my door while I'm watching TV. I check the people and there are two police officers standing outside. I'm just thinking, now what the fuck? As I open the door, I am greeted by two relatively large gentlemen in uniform, with shitty looks on their faces.
Can I help you, officers? Are you so-and-so? Yeah. Is there a problem? Only if you consider sexually assaulting a young woman to be a problem. Can you provide your whereabouts for the last 2 hours?
I was internally shitting myself, but I responded, "Well, I just got home from work like 45 minutes ago. And what do you mean sexually assaulted? Who told you that?" This insane bitch stepped up her game, calling in a false police report and getting the cops to come question me about it. That is bold. The cop responds,
"I'm not at liberty to provide that information. But I do need you to provide some proof that you weren't in the Galt area between the hours of 2 and 5 this afternoon."
Now I'm actually starting to get pissed, knowing that I am 100% innocent of this allegation. And so I kind of get an attitude, which didn't help my situation at the time.
"If you go to my place of work and verify that I was there till 4, that will prove that I had nothing to do with this. And furthermore, the person accusing me of this crime, are you going to arrest them for filing a false police report?"
What I heard next floored me.
"I'm not so sure it was a false report. Your car is still warm, and you look guilty." "No fucking shit, my car is warm.
I just drove home from work less than an hour ago, Einstein. How about doing some detective work, Chief?
They eventually left my apartment, but before doing so they told me not to leave, and they would be back if my story didn't check out. Well, they never came back, and I called into the police station multiple times to get an update. And you know what they told me? No police report had been filed, and there was no record of any police being dispatched to my address on the day in question.
How the fuck?
I was seriously about to lose my mind. How could she continue to do this, with no consequences? Mind you, I'm still receiving texts and calls. Less than in the beginning, but they were still coming in. I think it was like a week or so and things have finally calmed down, minus the calls and texts, but even those weren't coming in that heavy anymore. I started to think that she was done, and I might be able to get back to living my normal, drama-free life. But no. I stop at my mailbox after work about a week or so after the whole police situation, and received a letter from the post office that said I had changed my address, but if this was incorrect to contact them to stop the mail from forwarding. So I called them right away and told them that I haven't moved nor have I filled out a change of address form, so there's no reason to forward my mail elsewhere. They ensured me that my mail would continue arriving at my current address and that I had nothing to worry about. Well, they were full of it, because I didn't get a single piece of mail for the next 2 months after that day. It took 3 phone calls and 2 visits to get it rectified. Now, had it just been me not getting my mail, I wouldn't have been that pissed. But once my mail was forwarded to the address where Crazy was getting it, she used it as an opportunity to get all of my account information for my electric, gas, phone, cable, car, and banking information. I had extra security set up on my bank account so I was safe there, and my car payments weren't going there anyway. But she managed to shut off my cable, electric, and my gas. I also got phone calls from my phone company stating that charges would be applied to my account if I didn't call in. I was furious. I ended up paying an extra $300 in fees to get everything put back into my name, mainly because my apartment complex ended up paying the balances on both accounts and then charged me for it. This was all getting to be too much. I tried calling the cops, and they just kept asking me if I had gotten a restraining order. I explained that I had tried, but she continued to evade being served, and after a period of time, if the person isn't served, it's no good. Their response was,
"Well, we can't help you."
Wow, thank you. You can't help me, but you can follow up on a false police report and then ignore that shit like it never happened. Gotta fucking love the cops around here. However, I got a break. If you remember, I mentioned earlier that she was arrested for smashing some dude over the head multiple times with a beer mug. Well, that finally caught up to her, and she got convicted and was given 3 months in jail. Just 3 months. Are you kidding me? There's no way in hell I could go out and beat some guy with a glass object and not get at least a year or longer for that. But somehow she squeaks by with ease. Either way, that meant peace and quiet for at least that period of time. From time to time, I would check in on her status in jail, just to make sure her ass was still locked up. One day I checked and saw that she had been released 2 days prior. In my head, I screamed as loud as humanly possible and started to get paranoid about what this girl might do next. Weeks went by and nothing. Finally, she had given up, or so I thought. A few weeks ago, it started with a text. It was a picture of a pregnancy test that showed positive. It came from a number I had never seen before, so I wasn't sure who it was, but I had my suspicions. Figuring it was her, I text back saying, "Haha, finally, any ties to you I had are broken.
Have fun with the poor schmuck who knocked your crazy ass up.
You obviously don't know who this is.
Which was true, and it really got me thinking, considering I had talked to a few other women since being with my ex. Either way, I ignored it and just hoped it would go away. Over the next week, I kept getting texts, only that one picture, nothing else. Once again, I kept ignoring it until I got another message. This time it was a picture of a woman holding her stomach, showing that she was pregnant. Her face was cropped out. Immediately after that, there was another text that said, "I guess we know who the fertile one is out of the two of us now, don't we?" That right there told me it was my ex. We had actually tried to have a kid, but were never able to. Thank God. So I responded back. "Awesome. Have a great life with whatever schmuck you managed to get to impregnate you. Now, kindly, fuck off." She replied back with stupid insults that are irrelevant to the story, and I just ignored them anyway, figuring that she had done what she wanted. Rubbed in the fact that I could possibly be sterile, which to me was a win-win. I can't have kids, and now she's got other shit to deal with that'll keep her from bothering me. A week or so went by, and I'm the type of person that tends to do shit last minute. So when it comes to waking up in the morning and going to work, I sleep as late as I possibly can. So when I get to my car, I need to leave right away or I could end up being late. So I'm heading to my car when I notice that something is stuck on it. There are three magnets on my car with stupid ass slogans on them. I really didn't pay attention. I just needed to get them off my car because I had to go to work. What I did notice is that the bitch superglued them to my car, so it wasn't easy to get them off, and I still have remnants of magnet on my car. That wasn't the worst part of it, and to explain this next part, I first have to tell a short story. I explained how Crazy got into using meth. Well, one day, when I allowed her to use my car, she went to go meet her brother at his apartment. They got into an argument. He owed her some meth and he didn't have it, but she thought he was holding out on her. In turn, the brother wanted to leave. And in an attempt to stop him, Crazy used my car to barricade him in. And when she did this, he got out and kicked in my driver's side window, and then got into his truck and proceeded to run into my car until she moved out of the way. So I didn't have a driver's side window for the longest time. He didn't have insurance and is a fucking tweaker, so getting money for him to fix the window was pretty much impossible. I'm also lazy and do things last minute, so I never got it fixed. The weather here in California allows for me to drive around with a broken window and not worry about the interior of my car getting ruined. Anyway, back to the story. Now I have magnets stuck on my car, and I'm about to get in when I see approximately 5 pounds of dog shit with opened condoms just chilling on my driver's seat.
"You've got to be fucking kidding me,"
I think to myself, as I began looking for something to quickly clean this shit up out of my car. There was a plastic bag on the ground, so I grabbed it. And thankfully, the shit was dry, so I was able to get it out of my seat. I'm sure I still ended up sitting on some of it, but I had no time to waste, as I was already late and needed to get my ass to work. I got there and told my boss. Thankfully, he's a cool guy, and allowed me to take the first half hour off of work so I could clean it out properly. Needless to say, I have replaced the driver's side window on my car. Now I wait, wondering what the fuck this girl has in store for me next. My guess, something even more fucked up. I know I'm going to get these two questions. The first, why haven't I changed my number? And the second, why haven't I moved? To answer the first, I have too many people that know my current number,
and I'm not going to let that bitch win by inconveniencing myself and changing it. Second, I plan on moving, but I don't have the greatest rental history, so breaking my lease wouldn't be the smartest idea right now. So I'm sticking it out, and hoping crazy just fucks off. This story took place last summer. My brother and I, along with his girlfriend and a couple of her friends, decided to venture down to Bournemouth for the day, which is a large seaside town on the south coast of England. It's a gorgeous holiday location for the most part, but no matter where you are, if there's a large gathering of people, you can run into some very shady characters. While we were walking together around the park area, my brother's girlfriend said she wanted to head to the shopping center with her friends and asked if we wanted to join in. My brother and I, who I will call John, were not very keen on that idea. So he said that we would join her later. After parting ways, John and I kind of got sick of being around a bunch of people and wanted to go burn one before meeting back up with his girlfriend. So we headed to a nearby forest to have some privacy. Once we got there, I suddenly felt very anxious. We went from a crowded street to a quiet, isolated forest, and I felt that we were being watched. Those shady characters I mentioned before might be out here as well. In fact, they might even live out here. I stupidly ignored my gut feeling as John and I searched for a good spot to light one up. Once we picked out a spot and did our thing, I didn't really enjoy it, as I couldn't completely shake off that uneasy feeling from earlier. And what's worse, it only intensified once we were done. Suddenly I saw something out of the corner of my eye. There was a figure moving among the trees, approaching our direction. John saw it too. As he got closer, we both could see that it was a very tall, malnourished man who looked to be in his mid-40s, with long, greasy hair and missing teeth. We could tell right away that he was a tweaker. He shouted over to us, "Have you boys seen bugs around here?" John and I looked at each other in confusion and yelled back to him,
"No, man. No bugs here."
The man then shouted,
"Shit!"
and then took off in the opposite direction.
Okay, that was fucking weird. Just your average crackhead, I guess.
John joked, but I was not in a laughing mood. My paranoia increased, realizing that we weren't alone out here. And I was left wondering how many more people could be around here. That suspicion was confirmed when not even a minute later, we saw an older man pull up next to us on a bicycle. We could both tell he was another tweaker. He muttered out his words the best he could through his last few remaining teeth.
"Are you guys here for the big thing?"
John quickly responded,
"No."
This time, he had a composure in his voice. I could sense right away that my brother was feeling the same levels of tension I was. The man on the bike shrugged and began to ride away. But he suddenly stopped, put his foot on the ground, then turned around and stared intensely at us, like we were not meant to be there. While all this was happening, I heard the sounds of twigs breaking in all directions. I looked over to see more tweakers emerging from the forest, wearing ripped clothing, bloodshot eyes, stumbling toward us like a horde of zombies. I didn't have to say anything to John. We quickly booked it in the direction we came from. My heart was racing, and my adrenaline was going wild. After what felt like 10 minutes, I was completely spent. We were able to see the entrance back into the park area, but it didn't make me feel any better, as I kept hearing the sounds of footsteps behind us. John then turned around and said,
"Ah, shit, I dropped my joint."
He walked a few steps behind me and knelt down, moving the leaves around, looking like an insane person.
Hey, just leave it. We need to get out of here before they catch up with us. Just give me a second, man. Relax.
I looked up, and pure terror overcame me as I saw figures emerging from the tree line in the distance. I swear I could hear them angrily moaning as they staggered toward us.
Forget about the joint. I don't want to be eaten alive.
What?
The zombies, man. They're coming right for us.
I know that what I was saying was irrational, but at the time, I genuinely believed we were being pursued by a horde of the undead. You couldn't convince me otherwise. I didn't give him a chance to respond. I grabbed him and forced him to his feet. We managed to make it out of there, without so much as a scratch or a bite. The tweaker zombies didn't follow us beyond the park entrance and slowly disappeared back into the woods. We stayed around the park and eventually met back up with John's girlfriend and told her about the terrifying encounter we had. She thought it sounded hilarious. We can laugh about it now, but my brother and I were still shaken up about it. I still question what intention those crackheads had and why they were there with us. My best guess is that we got in the middle of a huge drug deal. Maybe the first guy we saw was the dealer, and once we scared him off, the tweaker zombies probably thought we were the ones slinging, or maybe it was something else. I will leave it up to the imagination of the viewers. One thing is for sure, I will never venture into unfamiliar territory again, especially while under the influence.